By now you should have read Chapter 3 and completed the Chapter 3 reading quiz. This week's video clip reviews important concepts in the reading and also builds on that foundation. The Earth's atmosphere is one of our most unappreciated resources, and clearly we couldn't live without it. You've likely heard the story of the two young fish swimming along, and they happen to meet an older fish swimming in the other direction. The old fish nods to them and says, "Morning, youngsters, how's the water?" The two young fish swim on a bit, and then one of them looks at the other and says, "What the heck is water?" Just as the fish live in water without a thought, so too we live in air, and we rarely stop to consider its importance. This week's lesson introduces us to this vital resource. Here's the topics we'll cover. First, as always, a definition. Your book defines atmosphere as follows: gaseous layer that surrounds the Earth. Notably, this includes all the gases that make up the air around us, but it also includes the gases in the soil and the water, and even the gases within us and other living organisms. For the most part, though, we will be studying the atmosphere that surrounds us and the solid Earth. So why should we care about the atmosphere? Clearly, the Earth's atmosphere is what makes life, as we know it, possible on Earth. But let's get more specific. What benefits do we derive from the atmosphere? First, obviously, it supplies the oxygen, carbon dioxide, and other gases needed by animals, plants, and other organisms. Perhaps less obviously, it helps maintain and distribute the Earth's water supply. It also insulates the Earth against extreme temperatures, and it shields us from the sun's ultraviolet rays. Stop and think how each of the processes mentioned above works. So where is the Earth's atmosphere? Well, first we need to note that the Earth's atmosphere is very thin compared to the thickness of the Earth. And this is apparent when we view the Earth from space. The Earth's atmosphere looks thin and fragile. Indeed, if we compare the thickness of the atmosphere with the thickness of the Earth, the atmosphere is very, very thin. See from Figure 3.2 in your textbook, over half of the atmosphere is within only 3.8 miles of the Earth's surface. And over 98% of the Earth's atmosphere is within 16 miles of the Earth's surface. Compare that with the Earth's diameter of about 7,900 miles, and wow, you get an idea of how thin our atmosphere really is. Notably, the gas molecules that make up the atmosphere are not spread out evenly over that whole area. Rather, the greatest percentage of gas molecules are near the Earth's surface, and the molecules get more diffuse with increasing altitude. Check out Figure 5.3 that we'll encounter later in the textbook. You can see that the density of the molecules decreases as you go up. Perhaps you've experienced this phenomena if you've hiked at high altitudes. It's hard to breathe and you get tired easily. Why? There's simply less atmosphere, and more specifically, there's less oxygen for you to breathe. Your body is used to a slightly higher percentage of oxygen, and it has to work harder to meet your oxygen needs. Elite athletes like to train at high altitudes, as their bodies get used to the low oxygen levels, and when they return to sea level, the extra oxygen helps boost their performance. So why are all the gases of the atmosphere held close to the Earth? Gravity, the Earth's gravitational pull, holds air near the Earth, just as it holds you on the Earth. The Earth's atmosphere is composed primarily of gases, but there are solids and liquids present in the air as well. The solid and liquid droplets are called particulates, and we'll discuss them later. First, let's deal with the gases. Amazingly, over 99% of the Earth's atmosphere is made up of simply two gases, nitrogen, N2, and oxygen, O2. The abundance of these two gases stays fairly constant from one place to another and from one time to another. We call these gases, and others like them, the permanent gases of the atmosphere. Notice that argon is the third most abundant gas. In fact, in general, there is more argon in the atmosphere than all the other remaining gases combined. This is an important point. Carbon dioxide, ozone, sulfur dioxides, and all the other air pollutants that you hear about are present only in trace amounts. This doesn't mean they are not important, however. In many cases, trace amounts of these gases can lead to conditions hazardous to human health and/or to the environment. So nitrogen, oxygen, argon, and a host of other gases here are permanent gases. Their concentrations do not change much over space and time. Variable gases, on the other hand, are gases that change in abundance from place to place and from time to time. Notably, they are present only in very small amounts. However, they can have huge effects on climate and/or human and environmental health. The diagram here lists three very important variable gases: water vapor, methane, and ozone. Notably, they should have also likely included carbon dioxide, as that gas is variable as well. So what's important about these variable gases? You should briefly be able to describe the importance of each one. Review your text if you are unsure. Notably, water vapor, methane, and carbon dioxide are especially important for climate and climate change, or global warming. How and why? What are the specific sources for each of these gases? Ozone is a bit different. In the troposphere, it's an anthropogenic, human-made, pollutant, and also a greenhouse gas. But in the stratosphere, it helps protect the Earth from the sun's ultraviolet radiation. One final note about the variable gases for now. Look at the volumetric percents listed for water vapor. 0 to 4%. That's a pretty wide range. It's often present as a trace gas, but sometimes it can overtake argon and be the third most abundant gas in the atmosphere. Consider when and where water vapor is likely to be sparse, and when and where it's likely to be abundant. The atmosphere also contains tiny solids and liquids that are small enough to stay suspended in the air. We call the tiny suspended solids and liquids particulates. Another term for particulates is aerosols. Most people are familiar with liquid aerosols, as we have all used an aerosol spray of some sort. In the atmosphere, there are numerous specific types of particulates. Some of these you are most familiar with include liquid and solid particulates that form clouds, rain, sleet, snow, and hail. Dust, pollen, ash, and smoke suspended in the air are also particulates. Notably, particulates can have both natural sources and anthropogenic, or human, sources. Here in California, agricultural dust, blown up as tractors plow the fields because the fields were left barren, is an important particulate pollutant that can impair visibility and can cause or aggravate asthma and other lung conditions. So particulates can cause lung damage, but some particulates also play roles related to weather and climate. Particulates provide a surface for water to condense upon in the atmosphere. Substances that essentially absorb water from the air are called hygroscopic. Additionally, as it is likely pretty obvious, water drops, especially clouds and dust as well, can absorb and reflect sunlight, which changes the amount of sunlight reaching a region and can have an effect on weather and climate. You should be able to list several natural and several anthropogenic sources of particulates. Another important point about atmosphere composition is that the Earth's atmosphere has changed over time. Earth's early atmosphere was likely made of helium and hydrogen, and volcanic eruptions gradually modified it over time, adding carbon dioxide, water vapor, and small amounts of many other gases. Additionally, starting about 3.5 billion years ago, primitive life forms on Earth started using the atmospheric CO2 and releasing oxygen, O2, as a byproduct through photosynthesis. The emission of large amounts of oxygen eventually led to a dramatic change in the Earth's atmosphere. Indeed, components of the Earth system, like volcanoes and plants and humans, have changed and continue to change the composition of our atmosphere. Generally, these changes happen very slowly over geologic time. But sometimes, as in the case of huge volcanic eruptions, the change can happen more quickly. Notably, if we look at the geologic record, quick changes in our atmosphere often have resulted in mass extinctions. This is a bit disconcerting when you consider that humans are currently changing the atmospheric CO2 concentrations at a fairly fast rate. Are we causing another mass extinction? Ecologists tell us, yes, we likely are. We'll be studying climate change later in the course.